Hello, friends and neighbors. Today, Die Hard is a universally lauded classic watched every holiday season by millions of dads who just want a few minutes to themselves. Okay? Please? Please. But no one can predict the future, and when it was being made, it was a pretty tough sell. The role of hard-dying protagonist John McClane was offered to a number of people, including one 73-year-old, definitely not mobbed-up lounge singer. Let's talk about that for a minute. Let me admit something right off the bat. I wasn't really a fan of Die Hard until I started writing the script. I think I've only ever seen it one time before, and that was years ago, but Christmas was coming up, so I wanted to do a video about a Christmas movie. There are precisely three Christmas movies that I can tolerate, and since I don't know anything interesting about Miracle on 34th Street, and Love Actually, frankly, hasn't aged very well, here we are. That said, I am a huge fan of Live Free or Die Hard, the 2007 sequel. I think it is an absolutely brilliant parody of itself, and if you don't think it's parody, please recall that the movie begins with McClane throwing a car at a helicopter and culminates with him riding a fighter jet bareback through the streets of DC. Mwah. Anyway, the point is, I watched Die Hard to write this script and I was like, damn, this is a good movie. Now, like anything else, it should be understood in the context of its time. In the late 80s, action heroes were cartoonishly muscular, unkillable Ubermenschen. For reference, please see this actual poster for Rambo 3, released the same year as Die Hard, in which Sylvester Stallone's head has been shrunk in order to make his arms and torso appear bigger. Die Hard's great distinguishing factor was portraying John McClane as an average guy who could be hurt, and who definitely didn't sign up for this.
Got invited to the Christmas party by mistake. Who knew?
Which is why it's startling to learn that before going to Bruce Willis, the role of John McClane was offered to both Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone. Indeed, it was pitched to Schwarzenegger as a sequel to Commando, which means this could have been your Die Hard.
Remember, Sally, when I promised to kill you last?
That's right, Major. You did.
I lied.
And that's quite a different tone from the movie we got.
Kill you.
But before them, the role was offered to 73-year-old Frank Sinatra.
You may call me Frank.
I can call him Frank.
Not yet. I'll let you know when you can.
So in 1966, a book called The Detective was published. It was turned into a 1968 movie of the same name, starring Frank Sinatra as Detective John Leland.
What do you do, Mr. Leland?
He's with the cops.
You're kidding.
That's what I said.
Well, I always said a little learning in a policeman is a dangerous thing.
Hey, where are you going?
I'm going home because you and your friends give me a pain in the ass.
10 years later, in 1978, a sequel was published called Nothing Lasts Forever. Another 10 years later, that sequel became the basis for Die Hard. It had been 20 years since The Detective was released, but back in 1968, Sinatra had it written into his contract that if a sequel were ever made, he would have the right of first refusal. So, even though Die Hard was not really a sequel to The Detective, but because it was based on a book that was a sequel to the book that it was based on, they had to offer it to him. Sinatra selfishly declined, forever robbing the world of what could have been a musical action tour de force.
You hit me!
Yeah, and I'm about to do it again, too.
Side note. Everything else interesting I know about Die Hard has to do with Alan Rickman. 1. Die Hard was Rickman's first movie. Prior to this, he had been a stage actor. B. The script was changed during filming when the screenwriter overheard Rickman faking an American accent for the crew.
You don't work for Nakatomi. And if you're not one of them...
That gave him the idea for McClane to meet Hans Gruber without realizing it, allowing them to have a face-to-face without one killing the other.
I'm John McClane.
This, in turn, required the earlier scene of Gruber murdering Takagi to be restaged in such a way that McClane couldn't see Gruber's face. And third, for Gruber's death scene, Rickman was attached to a rig on a stage and dropped onto an airbag. Director John McTiernan told Rickman that they would count to three and drop him on three. Instead, they dropped him early, guaranteeing a look of genuine terror as Rickman presumably thought the cable had broken and he was actually falling to his death. Quoth McTiernan, "We counted Alan down from one to three and then dropped him before we got to three." That's a standard thing when you want to catch the look of surprise on an actor's face. Hollywood! Hey, thanks for watching. Please click some buttons below to ensure that the YouTube algorithm will prioritize my videos over those of others in the future. And please tell me in the comments, what Christmas movies should I be watching? For Calibration, Bad Santa, Elf, and anything with Tim Allen are bad. Love Actually, Miracle on 34th Street, and Die Hard are good.
I have to remind you, Sally, this is my week off.